Hi, this is Dr. A. In this video, we are going to talk about specimen processing and getting the specimen transported to the lab. So let's talk about specimen handling. Proper specimen handling is critical to ensure accuracy of test results that are obtained from the specimens that are collected. So analytes may change in composition and concentration over time and with temperature changes or exposure to light. And we're going to look at these variables here in just a few minutes. Tubes with additives should be inverted gently and completely 5 to 10 times immediately after being drawn. So be gentle. That thorough mixing will allow the additives to be evenly distributed throughout the sample, and that will give you the best quality sample and therefore the best results. An efficient and safe way to transport samples is going to be in a leak resistant bag with zip closure. The specimen bags are marked with a biohazard symbol, and they have a separate front pouch for the requisitions to prevent contamination of the requisition should the specimen leak. You really do not want a wet requisition, so use that front pouch to put the paperwork there. Specimen transport itself, the tube should remain upright during transport. That promotes complete clot formation when there's no additive present. It prevents sample contamination due to prolonged contact with the stopper. It reduces the likelihood of an aerosol formation during end capping, as there is no residual blood that is clinging to the stopper. So let's talk about time as a variable. The quality of test results depend heavily on the time between when the sample is drawn and when the sample is analyzed. The longer the interval, the more likely the results will be inaccurate. There's ongoing glycolysis, which is metabolism of glucose by the cells that happens in the specimen, and that is a primary cause of inaccurate test results. As a general rule, an end centrifuge tube should be delivered to the laboratory within 45 minutes of being drawn. And this is something to consider if you're sticking morning runs and you have a lot of patients to go draw blood from. It is helpful to do maybe a 30-minute round of sticking and then bring samples back down and processing them in, and then go back out and draw some more and then bring them back in. Also, it's worth noting that because fluoride inhibits glycolysis, glucose samples that are collected in gray top tubes can be held for 24 hours at room temperatures and for 48 hours at refrigerator temperatures. So a gray top tube would be ideal for glucose testing if there's going to be any delay. Blood smear should also be done within 1 hour of collection, because EDTA will eventually distort the cell morphology. So let's talk about temperature for warm and room temperature specimens. So specimens that must be maintained at 37 degrees Celsius, which is body temperature, during transport and handling include specimens for cold agglutinins, cryoglobulins, and cryofibrinogen. The tubes for these specimens should be warmed using a heel warmer packet before the collection, and then the sample should be transported wrapped in the heel warmer packet as well. I have seen also nurses like just hold the sample in their hand, or phlebotomists hold the sample in hand and just try to keep their body temperature to use it to keep the sample warm and run it down to the lab like that. I've also seen some creative ones, you know, put it in a bag and then try to put it behind their armpit to try to use their body heat to keep it warm. I've even seen sand bath used. And then when you come down to the lab, if there's going to be any delay, maybe the machine's not ready or whatever's not ready for the testing yet, then the sample could be put into a 37 degree water bath to keep it at that temperature. Some specimens must be kept at room temperature. That's usually not a problem in the hospital, but if the specimen is being delivered outside the facility by a courier, if it's placed in an outside drop box or it's, you know, being driven around, then it should be put in an insulated container to protect it from extreme heat or cold. And if it's an outside drop box, that drop box should be insulated and such that it would be protected from extreme heat or cold. if the specimen needs to be cold or frozen. So chilling a specimen slows metabolic processes and keeps the analyte stable during transport and handling. Samples that need to be chilled will include a pyruvate and lactic acid testing and can also include ABGs, especially if ABG testing is slightly delayed, maybe the machine's getting calibrated or something. Then you want to chill the sample. To chill the sample, you want to place it in a slurry of chipped or shaved ice and water. The mix of water and ice will allow for complete contact between the sample and the ice bath and properly chill the sample. If you do just ice, it's not going to chill it as well. Some specimens must be kept frozen because some analytes are stable only in extreme cold, like clotting factors and complement factors. Those require storing at temperature ranging from negative 20 degrees Celsius all the way down to negative 70 degrees Celsius before testing. And then light. Exposure to light can break down light-sensitive analytes. Bilirubin is the most common light-sensitive analyte. Others will include vitamin B12, carotene, which is also vitamin A, folate, and urine porphyrin. There are also some other vitamins that are light sensitive. And it's worth noting also that bilirubin, for example, is also in a CMP. It's in a liver function test. So make sure that those specimens are protected from light. To prevent light exposure, samples are collected in amber-colored microtubes, especially for baby bilirubins. They can be also wrapped in aluminum foil or in an amber-brown biohazard bag and placed inside a brown envelope or a heavy paper bag. So let's talk about transport of non-blood specimens. Microbiology samples must be transported to the lab immediately after collection to increase the likelihood of recovering the pathogenic organisms. Most specimens are collected in transport media and don't need additional processing after collection. And most samples are plated immediately on culture media, often by the phlebotomist, which is trained to perform this task. If there's going to be any kind of delay, though, the specimen needs to be refrigerated at a minimum. And then getting to the lab, in many institutions, the samples are simply hand-carried by the phlebotomist or another member of the lab team. The samples can be dropped off at a designated area within the hospital for transport and delivery by the laboratory staff. There's even some robots that can move back and forth, picking up samples and delivering samples. The minimum information included on the samples and requisitions should be the patient's name, hospital number, room number, the specimen type, date and time of delivery to the drop-off area, and name of the person depositing it. And I would add to that that there should also be the date and time of when the specimen was collected and by whom it was collected. That's very important information too. And then some institutions will use a pneumatic tube system in which samples are carried in sealed plastic carriers that travel within a network of tubes. Shock-absorbing foam inserts are placed in the carriers to reduce the shaking and agitation of the sample during transport. Special containers are used to protect the sample and prevent contamination of other materials during transport. I've worked in a facility that used pneumatic tube systems. It's also very important to pay attention to where you're sending the tube to, because the samples can be lost in the system if they're delivered to the wrong area. So there you go. That wraps up a little bit on specimen processing, and especially getting the specimen to the lab. There'll be one more video about central processing. Thank you.